To start the show talking about Kamala Harris's plagiarism. I'm gonna go that far and call it that. And I thought there's no one better to talk to than Kyle Olson from Breitbart. Thank you for joining me, Kyle.
Thanks for having me, and congratulations on your show.
Thank you so much. So, Kyle, were you surprised that Kamala thought she could get away with plagiarizing Martin Luther King Jr.?
Well, what's interesting is this: she said this back in Elle magazine, which I don't know a lot of people that read Elle magazine, first of all, but she said that in October. And I think it was very fitting because you've got Joe Biden, who has a history of making up stories and embellishing stories and all of that. And so it didn't really surprise me that she would make this sort of story. And I give credit to the people who found it. But it's really fascinating that she would just sort of, you know, tell this yarn about how she was in a stroller at this march and somehow she fell out and her parents didn't realize she fell out. And then when they found her and they said, "What do you need?" And she said, and I just looked at her and I said, "Freedom." Isn't that a nice story? I think that's a nice story.
It reminds me, Kyle, of people on Twitter who tweet things that their children supposedly said, and they're always so profound, and they say things like, "Mom, I don't want Donald Trump to win the election. I'm scared." And I always think to myself, no one said that, but this is even worse because it's such a monumental event.
Well, and then I ended my piece that published last night with a story that she also told in Elle, where when she was elected in 2016, which of course was the same year President Trump was elected, and her 7-year-old godson was very concerned about Donald Trump being elected. Now, do you know any 7-year-olds that are concerned about who's elected president?
No, they're usually concerned about what am I eating next? And I mean, right now, probably when is school going to reopen? That's what I would think 7-year-olds would be talking about.
Yes, exactly. And so you've got Kamala Harris telling all of these stories and you've got Joe Biden telling all of these stories. And you have Elizabeth Warren telling all of these stories. And you just have to wonder, are any of these stories that they tell, are they based in reality at all? Or are they just to provoke emotions and get people to, you know, side with them on policy?
And Kyle, I want to read that quote that you brought up in your article. This is what Kamala said, that her 7-year-old godson asked her, "Auntie Kamala, they're not going to let that man win, are they?" And then she says, I held him. I mean, it still brings me pain to remember how he felt and what it made me feel, which is that I needed to protect this child. And then she goes on to say that she went up and did a speech and she ripped up her notes. And all she said was, "I intend to fight. I intend to fight." But Kyle, the thing I wanted to ask you was, because you had to read through this Elle interview, and I do send you my condolences for that. The author was so slobberingly, you know, praising Kamala. Some of the things she wrote about her, it was just fawning praise.
Oh, absolutely. And like, for example, the story said at some point she fell out of the stroller or fell from the stroller. And then she put in parentheses, "Few safety regulations existed for children's equipment back then." Oh, really? I didn't know that. But it was like she had to justify why she's, you know, making up this story.
Right. And that's when the press really does their due diligence, is when they're, you know, looking into strollers. They don't actually check many other facts, but they wanted you to know that this story's true because there wasn't a lot of seatbelts in strollers back then. Kyle, I also wanted to ask you, what are your thoughts right now on the Georgia runoffs? Do you have a gut feeling about what's going to happen?
Well, I talked to Marjorie Taylor Greene last week, and she was concerned that there was sort of a suppression going on of the turnout. She now represents the most conservative district in the state, and she said, you know, a lot of the Trump supporters in her area were not turning out, and they were frustrated because of how the 2020 election went. They were frustrated because Loeffler and Perdue were not being more forceful in saying that they were going to object. Now, of course, Loeffler came out last night, I think it was, and said that she is going to object. The president obviously was there last night, And but, you know, I think people see that there is a lot on the line. And when you've got Lynn Wood and others saying, you know, this needs to be a protest vote and, you know, don't vote and teach these people a lesson and all of that, I think they realize there's a lot more at play here. And you're talking about the literally the majority of the U.S. Senate is on the line. And do you want to have a 50-50 tie where Kamala Harris, of all people, is the tiebreaker and effectively gives the majority to the Democrats?
Right. And it's kind of amazing. And I saw that Ben Shapiro tweeted this today, that this guy, Raphael Warnock, is the better of the two candidates. And he's a radical. And he seems like the stronger candidate in this case. And it just shows you where the Democrats are at and what kind of people they're trying to run. Because this guy, I mean, he's been praised by Jeremiah Wright, Fidel Castro, or he has praised them. But do you think that the Democrats right now, that they're ever going to rein it back, or are they just going to get more and more extreme?
I think it's definitely the direction that they're heading. Now, the question is, have they been able to fundamentally transform the way elections are done? You look at Michigan, where I live, where we saw this huge surge in absentee ballots because the Secretary of State, who is a progressive activist, knew that Democrats, or at least in my opinion, knew that Democrats could more effectively manipulate and own at the absentee balloting process versus going in person to vote. And so that's what they shifted to. And of course, the situation was the same in Georgia and in Colorado and states across the country. And so what this comes down to is, are the Democrats going to be able to fundamentally transform the way we're doing elections and win these elections through absentee voting, through made-up ballots, and all of the other allegations that we've seen in Michigan and elsewhere? Are they going to be able to do that? Or are the Republicans going to win the majority, keep the majority, win those two Senate seats, and then actually be able to do some sort of investigation into the voter fraud allegations that we've seen across the country?
Now, I hate to even run this hypothetical by you, but I do think we have to. If the Democrats win and they do take the majority of the Senate, what do you see Joe Biden doing as the president? I mean, I don't even like to say that because I know there's still a lot of people who have, you know, hope that there's going to be some last minute surprise. But it does seem as the days go on that it's looking more and more likely we're going to have a president Joe Biden. Do you think what's going to be on his agenda? What's he actually going to try to push through? Is he going to be a moderate, or is he going to go with the squad?
Well, I don't think any moderate goes down to Georgia to campaign for two Senate candidates and says, if these two people win, we're going to be able to change America. And I don't believe any patriot or any person who loves the country wants to fundamentally transform the country, as Joe Biden's previous boss, Barack Obama, said. Progressives are all about fundamentally transforming America. And what that means is getting rid of our economic system, getting rid of private property rights, getting rid of individual rights, treating us as a collective. And so when you have a John Ossoff or a Raphael Warnock or a Stacey Abrams or an Elizabeth Warren or a Gretchen Whitmer, I mean, the list is long, unfortunately. But when you have those sorts of individuals wanting to dictate to you how you are going to run your life, that is not about freedom. That is not about how America has been run. And unfortunately, it just seems to me like the Democrats continue to go farther and farther left. And I mean, do you really think if Joe Biden is sworn in, do you think he is going to be in charge, or do you think Kamala Freedom Harris is going to be in charge?
Freedom. I think Freedom's going to be in charge.
I could just hear her saying that.
Kyle, my next question for you, though, is because you're talking about this change in America. And what I notice, and I've seen that you've written pieces on it as well, it seems to be that the start is changing the language we all use and changing the terms we all use and really making people feel as though there's a good way to speak and a bad way to speak. And I know you wrote a piece on Pelosi introducing these gender neutral language in new rules for Congress. Tell us a little bit about that. And does it scare you as much as it scares me?
Yes. I mean, basically what they're trying to do is they're trying to strip people's identity and what makes us unique, and not our race and our gender and all of that, but But that combined makes us unique individuals. And what they want to do is they want to have this gender-neutral language, even though if you go to her Twitter bio, at least as of yesterday, she still lists herself as mother and grandmother. But what she wants is for the House rules, which basically means, you know, any piece of legislation, anything like that, would strip out any sort of gendered language. And so that is the direction, you know, you talk about the fundamental transformation of America. That is the direction that they want to take the country. And so what this boils down to in Georgia and in future elections is this how we want America to be run? Is this how we identify as Americans? Or is there some other direction that we need to go?
Yeah, and we know that all the celebrities, the A-list stars, have been really pushing for the Democrats in Georgia. It's been an extremely expensive race. We will keep everyone posted on how that plays out. We're hoping the Republicans can win. If anyone is listening from Georgia, I don't know if we reached that far yet, but make sure you get out and vote. It is very important. Kyle Olson, thank you so much for joining me. I don't think you have a Twitter, but people can find your stuff on Breitbart.
Yes, you can find me on Breitbart, or you can go to Parler or Twitter, and I'm Kyle Olson, O-L-S-O-N, and the number 4.
Oh, awesome. All right, great. Thank you, Kyle, so much for joining us. We'll have you on again for sure. Guys, we have a lot more to get to today. I also want to give a shout out. We were just talking about stations. You know, if there's any stations in Georgia that want to hop on board, now's the time. But I wanted to give a shout out to WTSN, WTPL, WEMJ, the Binney stations, and also RKO for broadcasting us and having faith in us. And we are going to bring you more on the other side. We got the poll question, and I want to talk a little bit more. You know what? Maybe we'll open up the lines here because I want to talk a little bit more about the Democrats and their pattern of making up stories. I've never seen anything like it. And Jared just pointed out to me during the break, speaking of Democrats, Charlie Baker. Taylor made that loop. Charlie Baker's famous for making up these stories. So if you want to call in, it's the same line as Howie's show, 844-500-4242. We will be back on the other side. This is The Grace Curley Show.